I recently did a video and followed it up with a newsletter piece, newsletter link below, on issues with the 12-factor app, and most importantly, with the absolutely asinine way that the 12-factor methodology insists on storing secrets in the process environment, despite the fact that the process environment is not a protected memory space, and .env files usually used to load the environment at application start are responsible for hundreds of thousands of domains being compromised by hackers. So today, we're going to talk about a more sane way of storing and, of course, retrieving and using secrets, and more importantly, why specific techniques are more or less sane or reasonable than others. That's also going to require a conversation about security models in general and trade-offs between security and convenience and uptime. This is the kind of information that a lot of developers I've worked with would consider someone else's problem, and they consider themselves to be too important or too educated to have to deal with such pedestrian details. They would say they should be the responsibility of the IT or SRE or DevOps or whatever lower life forms inhabit the less privileged levels of their particular company from their point of view. I can say with zero hesitation, I believe that that developer mindset is a big part of the reason that the internet's quality has taken a nosedive over the previous decade or two. Now, those developers are not inherently irredeemable, assuming they're willing to listen and learn. But those developers who not only have never bothered to learn, or think through any of this stuff, but that also think it's beneath their station to learn, can, as far as I'm concerned, and should, go get... This is the Internet of Bugs. My name is Carl. I've been a software professional for more than 35 years now. I started this YouTube channel just over a year ago to answer some career questions from some CS majors I met, and I've stayed on the platform to try to do my part to reduce the already egregious number of bugs we all have to deal with on the internet day after day after day. Today, I'm talking about securing cloud application servers, at least to some level of detail. Here's the deal. I don't want to get way down the details of exactly which commands to run because one, the cloud vendors change things all the time. It wouldn't be long before the advice would be stale. Two, different cloud providers do it different ways, and I don't want to get into if this, then that, if this, then that. And most importantly, I trust you all to figure out what commands to run and what configurations to make to get something accomplished once you know that that is what you ought to be trying to do. It's kind of like dealing with AIs. The AIs these days, at least the web-connected ones, are pretty good at digging up the right documentation for you to read to implement something once you know what to ask for. The trick in what I'm trying to give you is an understanding of what you want to ask for and why. Because the AIs are awful at suggesting the right questions to ask for a given situation, because that comes from experience and not from copy-pasting Stack Overflow. So let me start this video with a discussion of threat models and security postures to set the stage for a little more specific things in a little while. The conventional wisdom and best practices for security have been all over the map throughout my career. When I started, most commuters on the internet had no kind of security protection at all, and no one saw that as a problem, really. Then we went through some years of people rolling their own, if they had anything at all. Then most everybody started using dedicated firewall machines or firewall features of dedicated network gear in between their on-premise networks and the internet. And then the cloud happened, and customers largely stopped having to configure their server networks anymore at all. And a lot of those people stopped really paying any attention to securing their cloud-based servers at all. And a whole generation started that never knew anything except the cloud and mostly didn't realize that there had been anything security-related to pay attention to in the first place. I tell you this because I want you to understand that there is a ton of advice and so-called security principles floating around on the internet, and you need to be careful that the advice you're reading and taking is relevant to the situation that you're actually in. Put a pin in that. We'll come back to it. Next, we need to talk about vulnerabilities. The easiest way to think about this for our purposes today, though, is not about race conditions and memory safety and all that stuff, but rather in economic terms. There are an unknown number of people out there who are looking for vulnerabilities in things and selling them. And the more widespread a piece of software is, the more any vulnerability in that piece of software will be worth. There's an amazing amount of money in that ecosystem. In addition, the more difficult a piece of software is likely to be to crack, the more expensive a vulnerability for it will be worth. That difficulty to crack thing is kind of fuzzy, but let's just say that in general, assuming that the same install base, a vulnerability in something written in Rust will be worth a lot more than one written in PHP. The practical implication of which is, these days, if someone wants to compromise your application servers, and they want it badly enough to pay an exorbitant amount of money for it, they probably can compromise it, at least to some extent. These vulnerabilities that can compromise even the best defended sites and software are called zero days, because it's been 0 days since the vulnerability was disclosed to the public. Zero days are incredibly valuable, but once they get used, then the clock will start on the vendors trying to patch those vulnerabilities, and they stop being so valuable. This is why the large online companies have dedicated security teams that look for such compromises and try to mitigate them, hopefully before they really get any traction. Quick aside, the single most complicated flowchart I have ever seen in my entire life, probably by an order of magnitude, it's not even close, was for the login authentication process at Amazon. Presumably, every security issue Amazon has had since 1994 has resulted in additional nodes and squiggles on that chart, trying to prevent that issue from happening again. I stared at it for like an hour or two until I got a headache, and then I closed it and tried to figure out some other way of doing what I needed to get done. Small team or solo or even most early startup software as a services, by definition, aren't going to have that kind of 24/7 monitoring team. So the strategy for a small team is quite different, as are the best practices in the conventional wisdom. The good news, though, is there's not nearly as much to gain from hacking you as some target like Amazon or Microsoft, et cetera, but zero days have a trickle-down effect. As soon as the vulnerability is out there, bad people will find out about it, and then they can try to use it to get as much as they can. So what can happen is that you might have a vulnerability from a recent zero day that's so common that thousands or more other installations also have that vulnerability, in which case when someone writes code to scrape up all the information that can be found using that vulnerability, you're likely to get caught up in that script. And a script plowing through website after website looking for and exploiting vulnerabilities is how the 100,000 plus installations that were compromised via .env files happened. I mentioned that in my 12-factor video, and I put a link below too. Okay, so now hopefully we're on the same page about the landscape, so let's talk about what you should do about it. The first thing is to prioritize applying security patches to your application servers. That's a pain. It can be time-consuming, especially if the vulnerability is in some dependency you built your app on top of, and the fix introduces a breaking change. But you need to realize that signing up for being a software as a service vendor means signing up to have to keep track of and apply security fixes from time to time. Although for zero days, there is often a period of time between when the vulnerability is out there and when the patch is available. And then there's the extra amount of time between when the patch is available and when you can actually apply it. But the whole point of this, right, is so you have a life, right? So let's talk about mitigating things. So I'm going to talk about five mitigation strategies today. Obscurity, surface, depth, window, and payload. And then we'll talk through some concrete examples and potential action items. So there's a phrase in the security community, security by obscurity. It's normally used derisively in the sense that security through obscurity isn't real security. And in the case that you're a deliberate target, that's absolutely true. And if you get big enough that you become a deliberate target, then security by obscurity is not worth very much. But if you're just one of hundreds of thousands of sites out there that a random script is looking to see if a common vulnerability is present, obscurity is really useful. And the conventional wisdom security principles might lead you to ignore things that are really easy to do and can have a huge real-world impact. It's nowhere near foolproof, but the less common your setup is, the less likely you are to get caught up in some script kiddie's target zone. We're not going to spend a ton of time on that today. Just keep in mind that even little changes to file names, where they are, etc., can help you buy some time to get patches applied. Obscurity is the least useful of the strategies I'm talking about today, and it shouldn't be relied on alone or much, but it's often the easiest to implement, so don't overlook it. So surface is about the vulnerable surface area or attack surface. This is about minimizing the things that might be vulnerable, the things that could go wrong, and the things that you have to worry about. So for example, the fewer dependencies your code depends on, the fewer external libraries you need to care about vulnerabilities in. This also includes what security folks call hardening a machine, which is turning off all of the services and processes that you don't absolutely have to have in order for your application to work. Next, there's depth, which is part of the phrase defense in depth. This is about assuming that your first line of defense is going to fail, and then putting in something behind that so that even if the bad guy gets to the first line, they still need to do something else before they get anything useful. And then maybe an additional thing after that, and then maybe another one after that. So for example, this is things like encrypting files on disk, so that even if the bad guy uses an exploit to get access to a file that they're not supposed to be able to see, the file they got was encrypted, and they need another exploit or some way of getting the encryption key in order for it to be useful to them. We'll go through a multi-layered example in a little while. The next strategy is about window, which is short for time window vulnerability, which is a thing you can reduce, often drastically. So, for example, let's think about that hypothetical file that was renamed during the obscurity phase, and we keep encrypted, thinking about the defense in depth strategy. Now, imagine that after we read and decrypt that file into memory, we delete the file completely. We'll talk more about this later, so just for now, assume we can delete the file without repercussions. Now, not only does the attacker have to find the file, and then they have to figure out how to decrypt the file, but they also have to retrieve the file before the point where we've read it and deleted it. That makes it a ton harder for them, right? One time I got some snail mail. It was a mandatory disclosure letter saying that a bunch of my personal details had been stolen by a hacker out of the database of a financial institution that was local to a town I hadn't lived in for more than 20 years. And I'm looking at this like, I closed my account decades ago. Why is my info still in your online database? It's because no one bothered to think about reducing the vulnerability time window so that when something bad did happen, it was a lot worse than it could have been, arguably than it should have been. Lastly, there's payload, which is basically the amount of information that the attacker can get. If the attacker gets a copy of your entire database, but it contains no emails, no passwords, not even encrypted passwords, no customer names, no addresses, no phone numbers, no credit card information, etc., do you have to care? I mean, like I said in one of my other videos, if you don't store passwords, even encrypted at all, but instead have your customers log in using a link sent to their email that connects to their browser via cookie to an entry in your session table, then there's no password to steal and the session entries expire after a while, reducing the time window. And then you've got a lot less payload to worry about. Now, not every software as a service can get away with something like that, but if you can, it's not a bad strategy. All right, so we've talked through our principles. Now let's apply them to a database passwords for web applications, the thing that's normally stored in ENV files. So the configuration that resulted in the 100,000 AWS domains being compromised had Apache or Nginx running on a machine with .env files containing plain text passwords for services that contained customer data in a well-known format inside a web directory with permissions that allowed access and no HD access file or directive that blocked those files. So let's start there and talk through various things that could have been done, should have been done to make that more secure. So first off, Nginx and Apache were written for the purpose of serving static files, and people were using them just as reverse proxies, and those people were surprised when they served a static file when the attacker asked them to do so. Why would you use that? If you want a reverse proxy, maybe because the 12-factor doc said you were supposed to use a reverse proxy, or because that's what your app framework expects, or that's what you're used to, why would you use one where being a reverse proxy is a late addition bolt-on extra? You could be using HAProxy, which is a long-suffering, battle-hardened reverse proxy that can't serve files, or you could use Caddy, which is a new modern web server written in Go, where serving static files is a module that you have to explicitly enable in the config file or on the command line. So it won't be on by default. Using one of those two or something like them would reduce your surface areas and get you obscurity points as well. Now let's talk about the file on disk. That file contains the info for your application to talk to your database or whatever, right? Why does the user account that the web server proxy is running at even have permissions to read that file? Only the app server process needs to read that file. So only the user the app server is running as should have permission to read it. Defense in depth there. Now, compromising the proxy server doesn't allow the attacker to access the file on disk, though it'll get a permission denied error, and then the bad guys have to have another vulnerability in their back pocket as well. This is one of those things that get lost in most companies between the application developer employees who know what apps need and what credentials to talk to what services, and the IT DevOps employees who actually configure the file permissions of those servers. This is one of dozens and dozens of things that you get familiar with if you do your own thing that most developers have no clue about at all. And most code-focused ChatGPT answers probably won't think of either. Now, why are we putting the database passwords in a text file anyway? All the cloud providers have their own secret manager services that you can store the passwords in, and they also allow you to easily rotate and change the passwords if they get compromised, and on a schedule, just in case. So this is more defense in depth. We don't store the database password, we store the AWS credentials file, or Google Cloud or Azure, they're all similar, that uses AWS or Google or Azure or whatever, uses the library for your app server language to read the credentials file, use that to connect to the cloud server vendor's secrets manager in the cloud, and ask for the password that way. You can also, and I recommend this highly, make it so that each one of your application servers is using its own set of cloud credentials, in other words, a different cloud user account, and that those credentials are only good if they're coming from the IP address of the web server that it's assigned to them. This seems really obvious to me, but I've seen very few people turn this on for some reason, probably because they don't think about it. But I put a link to the AWS documentation on how to do that below. But again, pretty much all these kinds of features are available at pretty much all the major cloud providers. So if you're using a different cloud provider, it'll have something like that. So now if the attacker gets that file somehow, they can't talk to the database or the S3 bucket or cloud file storage or whatever. They can't talk to that directly. They have to talk to the cloud secrets manager first. And now they have to figure out a way to spoof the IP address that we're coming from. And now we're well into why wouldn't the bad guy have just given up by now territory? But I'm not done. I've built systems that secured hundreds of millions of dollars before, and I learned then to take security very seriously. So now here's their next trick. As soon as the application server process reads the cloud credentials out of the config file, we program it to delete the config file. Now we've made it so much harder for the attacker. But wait, if we don't have the config file, how does that work? So what I do is I have a different machine, or two if you're paranoid and want redundancy, that has no web service or application service running on it, usually only SSH is listening to the network, and with a packet filter so only certain IP addresses can even access the SSH port. Then I have that machine run code that just cycles through all the web servers and sees if they're okay. It's the same kind of health check that the load balancers look at. And then you define a custom failure code, usually some specific 500 code, that the app server returns if it doesn't have cloud credentials. When the admin server sees that code from a server, it puts a copy of the correct file for that server in the place that that server expects it via some mechanism like public key, SSH, SCP. Then the application server sees the file there, reads it, connects to the secrets manager, and then deletes the file. The window that the attacker has to try to grab that file from the application server is tiny and trying to grab the file from the admin server, if the attacker even knows that the admin server is there, is way harder because the admin server has virtually no surface area that the attacker can reach. And if you want to be really sneaky like me, use a different operating system for the admin server. OpenBSD is the one I usually pick because it's rare, it's very secure. It's not Linux or Windows, so most attackers have no clue what to do with it. You can also write the application server so that the admin server that gives out the secrets file talks to the app process directly instead of copying over a file, but that may require using the cloud client library in a way that people who wrote that library don't foresee, since they expect you to use it with a file the way they told you to, so that might have some issues. Now, do you have to do all of that? No. Will it help you sleep better at night? Well, it absolutely does for me. I know that even if there is a zero day out there that hits me, or if life gets in the way and I don't have time to get a server patch for a while, I'm pretty confident I'll be okay. Now, this does open up new potential problems, mainly that if my admin server dies or fails somehow, then if a web server reboots, it won't be able to start serving until the admin server gets fixed and gives it the right credentials file. You have to balance the odds of admin server goes wrong and application server reboots before it gets fixed against the odds of application server has a vulnerability. And that's true of all security steps you take. You need to understand what might go wrong, how you might mitigate that, like by putting up a second admin server and or having an alarm that pages you if an application server stays in the I need my credentials file error state more than a certain amount of time. But that gets into monitoring, which is a whole other subject for a whole other video or video series even. I have tons, really tons to say about. And we haven't really talked about payload, which is the thing you do so that if all the other stuff does fail, what the attacker can actually get out of your database is tiny and useless to them, or at least as tiny and useless to them as you can make it. Only what you absolutely have to have to do the work you have to do. And the reason we haven't talked much about payload is that without knowing what your app is trying to do, it's really hard to know what info you have to do in order to be able to do that work. We also haven't talked about a ton of other security issues and situations. It's a big topic, and if I tried to cover it all, I'd never get this video out the door. So some of those will have to wait for another time. Hopefully those has given you some ideas and some alternatives to the naive implementation in the 12-factor app documentation, as well as a ton of the Stack Overflow answers and online tutorials. Because just like the AIs that have memorized them, Stack Overflow and many, many tutorials on the internet are just full of bugs. And anyone who tries to tell you differently is probably trying to sell you a subscription to their new agentic AI code platform. Let's be careful out there.